the sword. A well-placed blow from this ancient weapon changed the course of history countless times. Carried into battle by warriors and kings, and instrumental in carving out empires for thousands of years. Despite advances in weaponry, for militaries around the world, the sword is still an important and symbolic weapon, even if it's rarely used on the field of battle. Still forged, hammered, and shaped by skilled blacksmiths. How do they do it? The Royal Navy, the oldest branch of the British military, has always valued the sword. From the time of the Spanish Armada, through the Napoleonic Wars, to its last recorded use in 1900 during the Boxer Uprising in China, when a British lieutenant used his sword to drive a gun-waving attacker overboard. Today, the sword is at the heart of one of the Navy's most important ceremonies, the Royal Naval College Passing Out Parade. This sword, first adopted in 1929, is a proud symbol of the Navy. But it's made 7,000 kilometers from Britain, in the foothills of the Himalayas, in Dehradun, India. Windlass Steelcrafts has been supplying the British military with swords since before Indian independence. Today, it's the largest sword factory in the world, providing the Royal Navy with over 1,000 swords a year. It's run by brothers Pradeep and Sudhir Windlass.
This business kind of runs in our blood. I mean, if you look at these guys, these are all blacksmiths. Their grandfather, great-grandfathers were all blacksmiths. It is the sword with which nations were carved, civilizations were built.
The first metal swords replaced Stone Age weapons around 3000 BC, when the addition of tin to copper created a strong metal alloy and gave birth to the Bronze Age. Since then, armies and soldiers throughout history have lived and died by the sword. A sheet of 6 millimeter thick carbon steel is sliced into 3.5 by 76 centimeter sized pieces. Rock hard steel isn't easily shaped into a blade. That means it needs to be softened. It's placed in an 850 degrees Celsius oven for 20 minutes. Once the metal reaches 815 degrees, it's ready to be worked. Salim Ahmed is one of the company's senior blacksmiths. Hammering a blade by hand is a slow process. One sword is all a medieval blacksmith could hope to produce, working sun up to sun down. So how does this factory make over 1,000 swords a week? A mechanical hammer speeds things up. The sword is molded into a rough shape before Salim refines it by hand. But a sword is no use unless it's sharp. The blades are ground to give them their cutting edge. Even though these swords are primarily for ceremonial purposes, the Royal Navy requires each one to be battle ready, just in case. After being heated and sharpened, the steel blades are now too soft, so they must be hardened. Each sword is heated again to over 800 degrees Celsius. The heat separates the molecules within the steel before the glowing blade is quickly cooled in a bath of quenching oil, forcing the molecules together, strengthening their bonds. No sailor will go into battle with an untested sword. So each blade is slapped on a wooden block. If the heating and cooling has failed, it will be too brittle and it breaks. Next, a traditional handle is crafted from stingray leather.
ये अलग अलग तलवारों में ये अलग अलग उस पे हैंडल पे यूज किया जाता है.
The skin is glued and tied with gold-plated copper wire. Without a guard, swinging a sword could lose you some fingers. Each sword has an ornate lion-shaped guard. It's too intricate to carve each by hand. So a master mold creates a wax version, which is surrounded by plaster. The wax guard is melted out, and the void it leaves is filled by a 900-degree molten brass alloy. Once the metal has cooled and the plaster is washed away, the guard is ready to be shaped and fitted. The sword is inspected and passes muster.
All the militaries, they take pride in the fact that they are holding a sword.
Although it's unlikely they'll be used in battle, they are ready for the next naval passing out and a new generation of officers.